everyone and welcome back to my channel. This is Irina and usually I talk about Germanic languages or Norse culture, but today I'm going to make an exception and discuss a political issue I find very exciting and worrying at the same time, because it is a test for democracy in Europe in general, which is the general Swedish election tomorrow. So the elections, actually, because there are parliamentary elections as well as local elections. So let's hope for the best. All right, so let's discuss a little bit about the Swedish parliament and how the elections work. And like I said before, because this is history slash language channel, I'm going to introduce some terms in Swedish for different political realities here. So we have Riksdagsvalet. Yeah, so Riksdag is the name of the Swedish parliament, the highest decision-making assembly. The elections to the Riksdag are held every 4 years on the second Sunday in September. So yeah, logically voters go to the polling stations to decide which people will represent them in the Riksdag. And in the same day, we have regional municipal elections. Overall, we have 349 seats in the Riksdag that are allocated to certain people, so-called mandates, yeah, mandat. The number of seats that a party gets is proportional to the number of votes the party receives in the election. The main rule is that a party nevertheless needs to get at least 4% of the votes to enter the Riksdag. When the polling stations have closed on the election day, the voters receivers in the polling station do an initial tally of the ballots, and it is this result presented in the media during the so-called vigils in the evening. It's not something typically Swedish, it happens in a lot of countries, but the final counting of the votes is done in the week after the election of the county representatives. So the electoral authority announces the final result of the Riksdag election approximately 1 week after. Who can vote? Well, you have to be a svensk medborgare, so a Swedish citizen, and you have to be 18 latest on the election day. So svensk medborgare som fyller 18 år. Yeah, anyone who wants to be elected as a member of the Riksdag must have the right to vote and be nominated, that is, appointed as a candidate by a political party. You can also vote in advance if you want to. So, rösta i förväg. Rösta is the word for to vote, which is interesting because it also, so röst also means voice. So, you're basically, expressing your opinion. So, you have a voice, you have a say in the political life. Yeah, so you can vote in advance, and you can also vote by post if you're, for example, sick or old, or you have either disability or other reasons for which you cannot get to the polling station. If you are living abroad, you can also send your vote by post. There are also different types of ballots in Sweden. So we have three types. There are the party ballots, partivalsedlar. Then we have the name ballots, namnvalsedlar. And then we have the blank ballots, blanka valsedlar. So voters can vote by choosing a party ballot that contains only one party's name, or a name ballot that contains a list of printed names of the party's candidates in order of rank. You can even vote in person by ticking a particular candidate on a party's ballot name, and you can also complete in writing the name of the party or the person you want to vote for. Is organized in constituencies, valkretsar. They are distributed between the parties, and they are largely corresponding to the division of counties, yeah, the so-called län. But the populous counties, such as Stockholm, Skåne, and also Western Götaland, so Western Gotland, consists of several constituencies. A normal-sized constituency elects approximately 10 to 12 members of parliament. The differences are, however, large. The largest constituency is Stockholm, like I said before, which, for example, after the 2018 election had 43 members. And the least is the county of Gotland, so the island, Gotland, with just 2 members of the parliament. All right, so Sweden's electoral system is proportionellt. So this means that the number of seats a party gets in the Riksdag is proportional to the number of votes that a party has received in the election. Pretty logical. Like I said, there are 349 seats to be allocated, and to each seat there is 1 mandat. Okay, so when the county administrations have counted these votes after the election, the Valmyndigheten, so the electoral authority, must distribute the mandates between the parties based on the election results. So yeah, we have this blocking rule, the so-called spärregel, that states that a party must receive at least 4% of the votes in order to receive a seat in the Riksdag. In this way, it is ensured that there will not be as many small parties in the Riksdag as there might otherwise have been. There is, of course, an exception to this rule, which is if a party receives at least 12% of the votes in a constituency. So then the party gets to participate and share the mandates in that particular constituency, even if overall they did not receive the 4% of the votes in the entire country, I mean. Okay, so we have these 349 mandates. They consist of 310 fixed mandates, fasta mandat, and 39 mandates of compensation, let's say, or equalization, utjämningsmandat. The number of fixed mandates that each constituency has depends on how many people there are who have the right to vote in that particular constituency. The distribution of these mandates then reflects the voting results in each constituency. The purpose of the other 39 mandates is that the distribution between the parties should be as proportional to the number of votes as possible. So these mandates of compensation are thus distributed in such a way that they correspond to the percentage of votes that the party has received throughout the country. Okay, so when the seats have been distributed, they must be distributed between the persons who are candidates for the parties. In other words, the members are appointed, so the ledamöter. So when these members are appointed, the parties' ranked lists of names on the ballot papers must be compared to the names the voters ticked or written down on the ballot paper when they voted in person. A candidate who is far down the party list can still get a seat in the parliament if at least 5% of the voters who have voted for that party in a constituency have voted for him or for her in person. If there is more than one candidate, reaching up to 5% of those personal votes, then the places are distributed according to the number of personal votes. And then when there is no longer a candidate with more than 5%, the mandates are distributed in order of rank according to the candidates who are highest on the party's list on the name ballots. So the electoral authority distributes the fixed mandates between these parties using a method of calculation called the odd number method, the smoothing number method. This means basically that the number of votes for each party is divided by a series of number until all mandates are distributed. Another important thing will be that the place in the Riksdag is a personal place, so we have personligt riksmandat. This simply means that if a member chooses to leave the party during the mandate, they are allowed to remain in the Riksdag, so without belonging to a party. Then again, a extra election can be organized, so held between the regular elections during an ongoing term of office, and it must be carried out if decided within 3 months of the decision. So if a majority in the Riksdag, for example, does not have enough trust in a prime minister or another minister, it can direct a so-called motion of no confidence against a minister. And if the Riksdag directs a motion of no confidence against the prime minister, they must so the government and the prime minister must resign and or decide about this extra additional election. All right, so the of the parliament after an election is to elect a very important person called the talman, so the speaker. There are also a couple of deputy speakers as well. This is not a political role, so he or she is politically neutral. The function refers to planning and organizing the work of the parliament. Another task would be to elect the members of various boards and committees, nämnder and utskott, because in these committees, the members of parliament, the ledamöter, prepare the decisions to be taken afterwards. All right, so when a new government is formed, as a consequence, the parliament and this talman speaker play the central role. What happens after the parliamentary election is that the prime minister, Staatsminister, has the right to choose whether to remain in office or to resign. If he chooses to remain, there is a vote on the prime minister in the parliament, and if more than half of the members vote against the prime minister, he or she has to resign. Otherwise, the prime minister can remain in office. If granted permission by this vote, the omröstning, and the point ministers and form a government, so regering. Say if instead he or she resigns voluntarily or after this omröstning, it is the task of the speaker of the talman to propose a candidate for the post of prime minister who can obtain the support of the Riksdag. Then the speaker initiates talks with all the parties in order to find out which candidate can obtain the parliament's support and confidence, and this is determined in a vote. If the proposal is approved, the Staatsminister forms a new regering, government. If not, the speaker holds new talks with the parties, and then the talman has a total of 4 attempts to find a candidate with sufficient support. So, in other words, if the members reject the proposal 4 times, there has to be an extraordinary election within 3 months. And according to the constitution, these rules need to be followed. So all the rules I presented, because all public power proceeds from the people and the Riksdag, the parliament, as in all Western democracies, is, of course, the foremost representative of the people. So one last thing about the parties, but this of course would deserve another short presentation. The current parties in the Swedish parliament and running for elections again, so from left to right are the following. So we have Vänsterpartiet, Socialdemokraterna, Miljöpartiet, Centerpartiet, Liberalerna, Moderaterna, Kristdemokraterna and Sverigedemokraterna. So from left to right. In the previous election, so 2018, the Socialdemokraterna won, if I remember correctly, about 28% of the votes, and they were followed by Moderaterna and Sverigedemokraterna. So it would be very interesting to follow what is going on and see what the situation there develops, because of course it is relevant for the state of democracy in Europe in general, just like I said at the beginning. Thank you so much. I hope you learned something useful. And if you like what I talk about, subscribe to my channel. Have a good day.